Good evening, everybody, and welcome back to, well, a long-lost episode of Beyond Room 313 Symposium. I know it's been a while, but we've been busy with other things, not just the channel, but life stuff and things like that. And also, we took a break from it to, like, make it sort of special. And tonight, we have a very special guest. Now, before I introduce our guest tonight, I want to talk about little experiences in life. Life is a very strange thing and how it resolves itself in so many ways over the years. In the mid-early 1990s, I'm sitting at home in New York, and I think it was either MTV or VH1. It's probably VH1. MTV didn't play music, I think, even at then, back then, came on. And just in the background, and I can distinctly remember it, now hearing this voice, this song, and this female voice coming out of it. Now, anyone who knows me knows that I love like Kate Bush. That's my all-time favorite band is Siouxsie and the Banshees. So I have a kind of an ear. I love even classic rock bands like Heart. I love a female voice is something that seems to appeal to me the most. And so I'm listening and I hear the song coming through. And although it was very typically produced like the records of the era, yeah, in the terms of how it sounded, a lot of the bands back then, what struck me was it sounded almost medieval. There was a strange structure. The opening was like a bridge. Then it had a chorus that was more like a refrain. There was two female voices and one very pronounced female voice that was very different for a lot of female voice back then. It wasn't a screamy kind of like the grungy kind of voice that was all the rage back then. It was more like a kind of it was just like something from a different time. And then it had a bridge that was more like two bridges that were like a verse and a chorus. It was a very strange song. And then I went in terms of structure, but it was absolutely beautiful and haunting. And it was one of those songs, the first time I heard it, the colors of the song kind of sunk into me. And they've been there ever since. Whenever I hear that song today now, and it's called Return to Me, and the band is called October Project, yeah, it never has left me. So that's who our guest is tonight, the former singer of October Project, Mary Fahl. And she's also...
Oh, it's Fahl.
Fahl.
Like Fahl, yeah, Fahl. Yeah.
Forgive me. Forgive my ignorance.
Okay, it's
okay. And she has a solo career, including what's possibly the bravest move in history, musical history, to actually record a version, well, songs from Dark Side of the Moon in 2011, and it absolutely works. So, Mary, welcome to, and I'm delighted to have you here.
Thank you.
Beyond Room 313 Symposium.
Nice to be here. I I'm a fan. I've made no bones about that, and I love the fact that you've got this beautiful team around you now, and that it's just more content coming, and it's great. I love the pub. I love this. I haven't missed the symposium. And of course, everybody who loves you loves just when you get in your car and just talk to us. And when you're not there, like you've been disappeared for a few days, we're like, oh my God, something happened to Thomas. Like, no. So people worry about you. So you are much loved and much appreciated. And I told you I was a little nervous today. There's so much that I would love, as I said to you, you know, pre-show, I could talk to you for 5 hours about so many things. We have, both of us obviously have an interest in, I guess I call it hermeticism, but I have a deep interest, I always have. And I love the books you've written, and I love it because they're so practical, down to earth and practical. It's for the same reason that I've become someone that reads a lot of Steiner now. I know he's very Christian based, but it's so darn practical, you know, and it went beyond him. You know, a lot of those movements, I'm very interested in history of all kinds, but that 19th century occult movement in from Blavatsky, Eliphas Levy, then Blavatsky, and then from Blavatsky to Steiner, or Blavatsky to 19th century Paris, also very interesting, very romantic. And all of that kind of culminating in a funny way in in terms of the Cathars or Cathars, the Theosophists weren't that interested in them, by the way. They were like, yeah, whatever. They were way, the Theosophy, which I got into when I was in my 20s, mostly because I lived in New York in a really dumpy apartment on the Lower East Side. And as you probably are familiar with it,
Can I stop you there?
Yeah.
There's every chance that you and I passed each other in the street.
I'm going to show
you something now that will jog your memory.
Oh, God, of course. Café Chenet. Absolutely. Café Chenet. So October Project played there, as you know. It was a hole in the wall. It's so tiny, I can't believe we fit as many people as we did in there. And it would be packed with people, and it was a happening every night. And so many good performers were there. Jeff Buckley used to open for us, go on or before or after us a lot of times. And Katel Kenick, just lots of people. And because it was owned by an Irishman who was, I guess, had friends in high musical places, you never knew who was going to stop in there. So Sinead O'Connor would be in there all the time. Sometimes she'd be sweeping up in the kitchen, and, you know, Bono every so often would come in, people like that. And but it was just, it was a place where it was that magical kind of brigadoon of music where it pops up and everybody was kind of competing with everybody else. I always think great art happens not only when there's a tumult in society, but also when there is competition. You know, when you have a couple of really good people and they're like, ooh, that's good. I got to top that, you know, and that's what happened there. It was a cluster. And so record companies were coming down and scouting talent. And that's how basically October Project got signed, because we played there all the time.
Right.
And you used to stop it.
What's to my shame and to my regret, I never saw his play.
But you never saw us.
Nope. And I was at the most obscure gigs there, like Gavin Friday on a Sunday morning.
Oh, yeah.
10 o'clock. No, to my great regret, I'm sorry about that. But having said that, I looked at the video again recently, and for a new band, and I don't mean this in a bad way, I mean in a good way, actually, you were older than a lot of new bands tend to be. You look like you're all in your early 30s and late 20s. Well, you look the youngest.
No, I'm not. I was up on the upper end, but we were all in our late 20s, early 30s. And we all had jobs that weren't awful, but it definitely wasn't what we wanted our life trajectories to be. And so I met Julie Flanders, who was the lyricist, through a friend on Fifth Avenue one day. And it was a strange feeling I had, like I had known her before, you know, that weird, just met her on the street, and she invited me to her birthday party the next night. And we became friends, and we both had, you know, office jobs in the city, just trying to survive. And I told her I wanted, you know, I was a singer and blah, blah, blah. And I was just about to give up on the whole thing. I had never found a group of collaborators that I liked, and I wasn't confident to be a solo performer, to be honest with you. So I had applied to Columbia. They had a post-grad pre-med program. And I thought, well, what else am I interested in? I'm interested in, you know, natural healing and herbs and vitamins, da, 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 da. Well, maybe I'll go there and get the prerequisites, and then I'll decide if I want to maybe be a naturopath or something. I want to just do something meaningful with my life. And I had already signed, I got my loans, I signed up for the courses. It would have been hideous because I'm very bad at math. So I would have had to take all those math prerequisites. And so concurrent with this, Julie invites me out to meet her boyfriend, now life partner, Emil Adler, and I go out to Montclair, New Jersey, and he has a garage studio next to his parents' house, and he plays me their songs. And one of the songs he played me was Return to Me. And I just knew from that moment on that we would form a band. It's just one of those, I know it. And I knew we were going to form a band, and I knew we'd get a deal. And I knew, and it, that knowing never left me. And we were, and again, we were all, again, late 20s and then going into our early 30s. The fact that we got a deal that old was astonishing. And, but it was do or die. It was, I always remember that line in Apollo 13, failure is not an option. And for us, failure was not an option, but we took our time. And what we did was really, we honed it and honed it and honed it and honed it. And, you know, what I loved about October Project were those with the harmonies, beautiful, beautiful harmonies and counterpoint and soaring melodies and passion, passionate lyrics. And all of that sort of suited my temperament and my voice. And when you put it all together, nobody sounded like us. And so, you know, we played around New York, all those venues you probably remember. And finally, we got a deal with Epic Records, and they sent us down to Nashville to make the record. And we made two records. I always liked the first one better because I felt that it retained that essence, you know, the magic, basically. And I felt that the second record, while good, made us kind of sound like a lot of other people. And anyway, we didn't have a hit and we were dropped. And that was that. That was the end.
Second album syndrome. It's interesting what you said about how you were about to give up and the gods intervened and brought you to.
Oh, yeah. No, I really made up my mind. I mean, that was that for me. And it's like, well, I guess it's not meant to be. And you have to be willing to walk away.
That's what happened to me here with Jason and Timony. I was ready to throw the towel in and just walk away. I was kind of like finished with all this off media stuff. And it was just at the right time that the right crew came along. At the time, I didn't expect it. You know, it's amazing how the gods work that way.
Oh, well, that's another whole subject we could get into, because that's something that's the story of my life. I always say you have to shake an apple tree to get that pear. And then the pear falls down, and that's how the gods let you know, here, that's from us. But you did the work, and we noticed. And that sort of magic has happened in my life so many times. In fact, after October Project, I thought, I'm going to have to learn how to write if anybody's going to give me a deal. I was a white girl in this business, and that's just the way it was. So I did, and I went, and it was very difficult. I had to go back to office jobs. I had to go back to, and it was, you know, it's humiliating, but I did it. And then I started getting a lot of really lucrative work with what I did. I was a recruiter and in the publishing industry, and I started getting thrown very lucrative work, and I worked out of my home. So I put all that money into making demos, and I learned how to write, which was the scariest thing I've ever done, because the bar was set so high with October Project. And anyway, I did it. It took me a couple of years, and I did some demos, and I got turned down. No, 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 no. And then I thought, all right, well, that's it. But I had enough money to put a band together and do what I wanted. So I started just doing some medieval music and throwing that in. It's like my show, I'm paying for it. I'm going to do what I want. And that's the thing that got attention. I started doing medieval Spanish songs, Ladino songs, and not the whole show, but, you know, peppered throughout. And suddenly a major record company started coming down, but they were toying with me as they often do. And they had a really bad idea for me that sounded really cheesy. So I thought to myself, I didn't work this hard, this long to take everything I've done and throw it into that. And I said, nah, I'm not interested. And boom, the minute I was willing to walk away from that, out of the blue, I get a call from Sony Classical, and they had me come up and audition for them. And they wanted me to sing classical music. And I sort of said, oh God, you know, I'm not a classical singer. I'm not Renee Fleming. I'm just me. And I just like it. And they said, well, we want you to do it anyway. And I did. And I sang sang a couple of arias for them, just my way, like a folk singer that I am.
Was this live in an office or something?
Oh, yeah. And you know, I'm gonna tell you the other thing. That's an awesome.
No pressure there.
No, and here's the weird thing that happened, because I've done that before, and it's really awful and uncomfortable. And it's never, it's just, it's so, because they sit there like this, you know, and something different happened that day. And I was singing Ben Idi Habibi, which is a Spanish song from the 11th century. And then I sang an aria of four of them, and something in the room changed. And I should have been a wreck that day, and I was very calm, just so calm. And I started singing, and I tell people this, it's the air in the room changed. And I felt that suddenly I felt the presence of, I know it sounds corny, but I felt my ancestors with me. I felt they were all there, all around me, my father, my grandfather, my old Irish aunts that had worked so hard to put my mother through college, and people like that, all of them. I just felt, oh my God, they're here. And wow. I wasn't singing for the suits. Suddenly they didn't even matter to me. I was singing for my people. And I was done. And Peter Gelb, who was the head of Sony Classical at the time, said, come over here and sit down. We'd like to give you this deal. What do you think about that? I was like, what do I think about? Like, I practically jumped into his lap. I mean, I was like, oh my God, I wasn't expecting that. And anyway, so I did an album for them, but it was that, but when everybody left the room, my producer who did my demo for me, he looked at me, he said, I don't know what happened there, but something in the room changed and I've never seen anything like that. And that's what happened. It wasn't me. I mean, that's never happened to me before or since. It happened then. And it was one of the most magical experiences of my life. And so that's enough about the music. And, you know, and then Sony, 2 years later, Sony Classical falls apart. They're bought out by this one, which is the story of the music business. And yep. So, they didn't renew my contract. I went back. I got signed by V2. Then I did The Dark Side of the Moon. So, I love that record. So I had such a good time making it. And I felt it had so much to say about modern life. And I always say, I wish that I wrote lyrics like that, but I'm just not gifted in that way. And, but I feel those feelings. So Dark Side of the Moon gave me a way to express all of my concerns about where we're going as humans in this, and I needed to express all that. And Roger Waters reminds me sometimes a little bit of T.S. Eliot, little bit. It's got that portent quality to it. And it just gave me a vehicle to express all those feelings. Dark Side of the Moon expresses this dystopian future that I'm very afraid of, this technocracy, that's coming at us full speed. And that I feel like we're losing our humanity in the process of it. And so anyway, I had a great time making that record, and re-released it this year in surround sound format. And through the lockdown, my producer who worked with me on that found the lost surround sound version of it, 5.1, all that kind of stuff. And I don't have that technology in my house. But he made me sit down and listen. We thought it was lost in a fire, and it was like, oh my God, I've never experienced anything like this. 5.1 immersive, all that kind of stuff. It's a guy thing, And anyway, I was.
It's a Jason thing, because I've never heard it.
Well, oh my God. Jason, I have to get you a copy of this. because we layered it so much. It's so much call and response, and I do all, a lot of the instruments and everything. So now when you have it in that 5.1, it's coming at you. It's a visceral experience. And
I'd love to hear that. That sounds amazing.
People get addicted to this. I'm going to, you have to, after this, send me your address. I'll get you out a copy tomorrow.
Thank you.
So anyway, that's the music end of things. And, but beyond that, as I mentioned earlier, I have an interest in, because I studied medieval history and literature, and I studied the troubadours and that whole period, you can't study all that without coming across the Cathars. And although there wasn't as much of an interest back in the late 70s when I was in college as there came to be, especially after Holy Blood, Holy Grail came out, which I have to admit, I loved that book when it came out. It was a great.
Oh yeah, there's nothing.
Oh come on, it was wonderful.
That was a gateway book for so many people into topics. The people can slag that off all they want. It was tremendous entertainment back in the day.
Oh my God, yeah, and you know it. Okay, you know, was it? Were they right? I don't know. A lot of the things about the there's a lot of bad information about the Cathars out there, you know, and because we don't know very much about them, really. Because when the powers that be at that time, that was the Roman Catholic Church, when they want to get rid of you, they're very thorough. And what they do, as you know, as someone of Celtic descent, they get rid of your language first, destroy the language. And that's a huge part of the culture. And they had the language of Ak. They spoke the Lusitane. They spoke a completely different. In fact, the whole culture of Southern France was really different than that Norman culture in the north of France. And so the Cathars, I think that we romanticize them. And I think the Cathars, we project anything we want to on them because we just don't know enough about them. So sometimes I laugh when I think about them and think, God, they'd fit into any, you know, German Green Party right now. You know what I mean? You're pescatarian. They believed in reincarnation. We think they came maybe some influences from Zoroastrianism in Persia, maybe that came down through the Balkans, the Bogomils coming down through Italy and then through the Balkans. Probably. And, you know, their story is a horrible one because they were called the good people. And they obviously were very impressive. I think that, you know, it was an equality of male and female, very unusual for the time. So of course, I could get rambling. So you got to stop me if I ramble. But the other thing is that after Holy Blood, Holy Grail, the whole Cathar story became about Mary Magdalene and Jesus Christ, and they were married and they spawned and, you know, blah, 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 blah. And if you know anything about the Cathar ideas of asceticism, and they were very anti-procreation and they were okay with sex if you weren't procreating, but they wouldn't eat any animals because they were animals that came as a result, you know, procreation. So they'd eat fish because they thought that they just replicated on their own. And So what, you know, you'd think to yourself, well, why would they be impressed with Jesus being married? Like, they wouldn't care. But I think that there were enough traditions in the area itself of maybe Mary Magdalene, you know, coming ashore there you've got to believe in oral traditions at some point. You just do. I know that they're dismissed in academic circles, but I tend to take oral traditions seriously. So.
Oh yeah, I mean, if you look at the Vedas in India, they've been actually correlated against the spoken ones against the actual written documents that have been found up to 13,000 years ago, and word for word, they're the same. Yeah. Jason is dying to get in here. What are you going to say, Jason?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah,
it's okay. There's a thread that I've been piecing together while you're talking here, Mary, that I want to bring up that we can take back from the oral tradition thing and what you were saying about projecting what we want to on the Cathars, which is something I wanted to say that. So you were talking earlier in the conversation about your beginnings with Hermeticism and everything and having a real interest in Romanticism. And then through your music, the kind of flowing lines and counterpoint and everything. Yeah. And to me, I'm a composer and a musician as well. And I'm a shit vocalist and a shit lyricist. However, I can write melodies like Wagner. Maybe not as good as Wagner, but melodies are my thing. So I wanted to ask you too, like with your music, with your experience as a vocalist and a songwriter, that kind of technology of counterpoint, melodic interpolation and all of that, is that something that you think is informed by Hermeticism or is informed by kind of that 19th century occultism where, you know, an oral tradition being passed down like through maybe, you know, Mozart was a Freemason and a lot of those guys were Freemasons in the 17th, 18th, 19th century. And I want to say they're...
NBC was supposedly, an initiate. I would say in my case, not consciously. I know that Debussy used to you do consciously try to incorporate things into his work and his compositions, things like that. I don't do that. Honestly, I'm not that advanced. So my answer for me is no. I mean, I'm sure everything that you read, you think, everything filters into what the output is, but not consciously.
Right. And that's what I think is the beautiful thing there, is that people who are occultists and initiates who do make art and who do make music, there's so much, if you want to say, subconsciously bubbling up from what has informed you, compared to a lot of the people who produce and write and produce and perform music, who are doing it kind of just as something that it's a rote and repetition thing that they've learned from someone else. I think there's a real depth there when someone is informed by something that might come from that kind of late romantic era. And it shows, and you can hear it in your vocals and everything, that, okay, there are people out there who, like Thomas said, you weren't like, or you aren't like one of the people who is just, you know, a grunge vocalist that was part of the zeitgeist of that era, that there's an extra quality there that, you know, I find that in other musicians too, like you mentioned Jeff Buckley, and there's just some of these people that, you know, you can tell that they're informed by something a little bit more mystical, even if it's more likely a subconscious thing or an unconscious thing, rather than someone deliberately trying to put ciphers into music or into counterpoint.
I hear a lot of clowned in October projects, especially in the vocals.
I'll tell you where my voice comes from, because all artists have a DNA inside them that comes from somewhere else. And for me, I had older siblings that we had all kinds of music in the house. So my oldest brother was the folky, and my older sister had all the female singers, you know, Dusty and all those people, and 60s singers. So they had more powerful womanly voices, not like the way most girls sing today. And my other brother was the prog guy. But I discovered on my own, when I had my own taste, I fell in love with British folk music. So my voice comes from June Tabor, Linda Thompson, and the great Sandy Denny, that I listened to them constantly. Of course, I loved it, like all teenage girls of the 70s, I loved Joni Mitchell and all that.
Yeah, definitely. I was going to say that. I could hear a lot of tonality of Joni Mitchell is very common in your voice.
There's no female that isn't influenced by her, you know? But that other element came in. I think that the romantic part was definitely the British folk element, definitely. So
it's a good influence to have, because that music has aged very well.
It has, hasn't it? Yeah.
I'll go into YouTube and I'll listen to all those bands from those English bands from back then. And they sound as amazing today as they did like 50 years ago.
I think so too. And of course, June Tabor, to me, is one of the finest interpreters of a song of the past, I don't know, 40 years, in terms of folk and everything else. She's just amazing.
It's also a very underappreciated musical genre as well, because it's been very influential to so many types of bands. It's kind of like, everyone all knows the classic genres, but that's kind of like seen as a subgenre, but it's actually much more influential than people realize.
Well, look at the work Sandy did with Led Zeppelin. You know, there was a crossover there, certainly.
Yeah, well, they started out as folkies as well. His name, the singer, did.
Yeah.
Back to the Gnostics. Back to the Cathars. What you said about this, but this okay. This kind of conversation I personally enjoy anyway.
Okay.
You said that the thing with the reproduction. Now that they went crazy about the idea of having kids and stuff like that. To me, that goes demonstrates a Gnostic viewpoint, because that's definitely a commonality they have with the Gnostics.
Well, so it's life denying too.
There has to be a definite connection there through the Bogomils, I think.
Yeah, I'm sure, absolutely. But that asceticism, I mean, they would have fit into any Buddhist community as well. They denied the corporeal aspect of Jesus. They didn't ever believe he was actually even really, it was the idea of him. And they even weren't bothered by euthanasia. It didn't bother them at all. I mean, the thing that bothers me about, because Gnosticism is so pervasive now, it's like Gnostic good, you know, everything else bad. Yeah. And I don't know, because sometimes that life denying quality bothers me.
Tremendous darkness in Gnosticism. Tremendous darkness.
And that dualism bothers me too, because I think things are a little more subtle than that. And which is why I like Steiner, because Rudolf Steiner, his ideas of good and evil are way more sophisticated and complex. And it's not that dark, you know, black white dualism of the Gnostics typically. Anyway, the thing that's funny to me though is that the minute that Holy Blood, Holy Grail came out, is that it was a bonanza for feminist religious scholarship. It was like, whoa, like the door opened up and they all walked in there so I think that's one of the reasons the whole idea of the Cathars that kind of took off. There are many reasons, and it was, you know, the genocide of it was horrific. I mean, absolutely horrific.
It's unbelievable. It's absolutely, and it does kind of justify maybe why the Gnostics were as dark and nihilistic as they were, because that was eventually visited upon the Cathars.
Yeah, absolutely. And the other thing that a lot of the religious scholars, especially the feminist one, don't acknowledge or just don't address, is that the Cathars were also just victims of the power politics of the time. It was really wealthy down there, totally different culture. And again, sometimes maybe a lot of, and they didn't tithe. Big mistake. Okay. Big mistake.
There was a huge resentment from the Frankish communities as well towards them because of their wealth.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, there was a sort of live and let live culture down there in terms of how it fanned out to the laity. You know, you had the perfect eye, of course. And, you know, I was always fascinated by that, you know, what was that consolamentum? What exactly did they do? It was some sort of initiatic experience, a sort of maybe a laying on of hands or whatever. I mean, I don't there was something extremely powerful that was an element of especially being a perfect eye in that momentum, which it was, you couldn't have sex, you couldn't do, so it was something older people did that were part of the community. And, but.
That was the only thing that explains the genocide, because otherwise it wouldn't have been so brutal.
And for me, what's interesting isn't the Cathars are fascinating, but it's the land. There's something in older than the Cathars that goes back. I think there's something there in the land itself. There's a sort of geomantic energy there that is really powerful, really powerful.
Well, and my friend Neil MacDonald would definitely agree with you, Dad, because he said the first time he laid eyes upon the Cathar countryside, it changed and broke down. He wanted to live there.
His
life was never the same again.
It's first of all, it's stunningly beautiful, and unfortunately not very wealthy anymore. You know, there's a lot of poverty down there as well, but I think that that whole area and the people in it, you know, before Christianity, would have been influenced by the Phoenicians. Any Mediterranean seafaring culture would have passed right through there. And so I think that there might have been a very strong cult of Isis there. Why not? Have you ever read any other work of a woman named Patrice Chaplin? Have you heard of her?
No.
Should have her on the show. So Patrice was a screenwriter. She was the daughter-in-law for some time of Charlie Chaplin. And she lived in that area for a long time and has had a long history there. And she got involved with a man when she was very young, who was from Girona, who apparently was from a long lineage of sort of you know, keepers of the secret. And the secret goes back thousands of years, and it had to do with the energies of the place, and that it was, that it, it culminates on this portal on top of Mount Canigou. And so this whole Renless Chateau, Holy Blood, Holy Grail thing isn't about, she said he never talked about the Magdalene. He never talked about any of that. He said, no, it's something else. It's something that's like a powerful energy. And that, that tower in Renless Chateau that the priest built there, that, you know, they talked about in Holy Blood, Holy Grail, had at one point a twin in Girona, in Catalonia. And so if you drew a line between Girona and that tower and the tower at Renless Chateau, put a line right straight through, right in the center is Mount Canigou. And on the top of that, according to Patrice Chaplin, there was a portal that everybody knew about. And that in order to experience it without dying, you would have to go through a whole initiation, an initiatic experience that involved, she, in the book, she talks about, she overlays a Venus magic square over that whole Languedoc area and Northern Catalonia, okay? And that there were points on this Venus square that would correspond with the constellation of the Great Bear. So they call it like walking the Great Bear. And you'd go from spot to spot. It would take weeks. You'd fast, you'd pray, you'd let go of your negative energy, blah, blah, blah. And she also said you had to hum the key of F sharp, that somehow that portal was tuned to a note. So all of this was fascinating to me. And I think there's something to it.
Well, we're big fans of geomancy here. So you're like, you're speaking to a, yeah. And I'll find it interesting. Before you get in, Jason, I often find it interesting that it's always mountains, isn't it? Mount Brocken in Germany,
absolutely.
Mountain hills, Glastonbury in England, Tara in Ireland. They're all Mount Shasta in America. They're always mountains.
Oh, yep. So she herself experienced this this portal, and her the way she describes the experience to me sounds an awful lot like what maybe those Eleusinian mysteries might have sounded like, because she said when it was over, she said it felt like being on a carnival ride that you have no control over, and it takes you to the past, to the future, just you're like, ooh. And she said she was no longer afraid of death. And that's something that you would hear anyone who was, you know, talk, you really weren't allowed to talk about what happened during the mysteries, but anyone who did, just they weren't afraid of death anymore. They transcended death. And she also said that the locals told her that Howard Hughes would come there all the time, that he was looking for something, that he was. So to me, that, you know, because obviously I studied the troubadours and all that, of course, I love all the Grail mysteries and all of that.
Howard Hughes, the aviator.
Huh? Howard Hughes, the aviator. Yes. Howard Hughes.
And that may be the connection back to Parsons.
That's right. That's right.
Wow.
There you go. So, and that he was looking, that it had to do with the technology of these portals that he was very interested in. And she also says people from NASA had called her about it, that they were, you know, who knows? I don't know. And she, just when you want Patrice to really tell you like something definite, she always sort of gets very vague, which is a little maddening, but she's a lovely lady. I haven't met her personally, but she's credible. And I would suggest that maybe you guys talking to her at some point. But anyway, she's written a couple of books, one called City of Secrets and one called The Portal. And but again, I think that there's something in that area that is extremely powerful. And the other thing is, why was the Anunnaki so interested in that whole area? It went beyond just Otto Rahn and his sort of romantic leanings and going down to study. They wanted something down there. They were looking for something. And then you of course covered all of that kind of thing. That fascinates me.
And the reason why I covered that was because, interestingly enough, the one aspect that was left out, that was noticeable by his absence from Holy Grail, was the whole Ariosophist Armenian. Did you notice that that wasn't in that book? And I kind of
thought,
because that's, if you look into the Germanic side of it, they were obsessed with that before anyone else. In fact, the whole obsession with the mystical Cathars probably really began with them.
It was, well, you know, and you think about Wolfram von Eschenbach and Parzival and all of that. Anyway, I find all of that absolutely fascinating. And so I wish I could go back. I don't think I'm ever going to be allowed to, but it would be.
We will defeat that. We will defeat that. We're going to win that war. I'm convinced of it.
I was so lucky because, you know, my husband is an oceanographer, deep sea. So I was lucky that he used to get to go to do these conferences, and they were right in that area there, right on the coast. And there's a big marine lab, a French marine lab there. So I was lucky that I would just go with him, and I got to spend a lot of time in the area because of that. So we'll see what happens. I have to tell you a funny story about my husband, because it has to do with octopus. So my husband has been down in Alvin. He would go down in this, you know, that little submarine out of Woods Hole that goes to the bottom of the ocean. And he was there when they first filmed these they caught two octopus at the very bottom of the ocean. And they were having sex, going at it. And they're like, oh my God, we got to get this on film. And so he was the chief scientist, but he always took down a cinematographer with him so they could capture everything. And so they get it back up. He sends it to a specialist in cephalopods and everything. He says, take a look at this. And she calls him a few days later, and she's sort of like, I don't know how to say this, but we didn't think this existed. These were two different species of cephalopods. That never happens.
Ooh.
And they were both male. Okay, so it was like, you know, gay octosex down there. But anyway, he wrote an article about it for Nature, and like within a week, it was on Jay Leno as a joke. So anyway, it was very funny. The other thing is, after I corresponded...
What? Spreading your legs, all 16 of them.
Right. Anyway, so, you know, you got to film some octoporn down there. But it's so funny because after we corresponded on our messages on Facebook, the minute I went back to my regular Facebook page, two articles about the octopus popped up immediately. And I thought, oh, there you go.
Yeah.
That's my cue. And so anyway, but the other thing I did want to talk with you about was I've been loving your movie reviews. You don't do them that often, but when you do, I love that you review movies within a sort of a context that is, you know, either the hero's journey or a sort of pagan context, or it's just a different way of looking at things.
Yeah.
And I love anytime somebody brings up Joseph Campbell in The Hero's Journey, I'm in, you know?
Yeah, that's the framework I tend to see films in. I'm a bit weird that way.
Yeah, like, no, but it's a beautiful way to see, because, you know, when I was in college, I took one course on literary criticism, and it was a good one. And I remember Northrop Frye, there's only two stories in this world: man goes on a journey or a stranger comes to town, right? And but you put it in this different context, and I love stories that involve the hero's journey or some form of personal redemption of some kind.
It always comes back to the monomyth, and I think a lot of films that go bad are like, I watched, here's a classic example. Last night I watched Knowing with Nicolas Cage. I'd never seen it. Yeah. And it's about basically the end of the world due to a solar flare. And some friends of mine suggested it. The film was absolutely magnificent until his redemption stopped and they passed the baton onto his two children who were rescued by the aliens. And you want to talk about a film that had a genuine power, a genuine gravitas to it, suddenly collapsing. It was because of this basic error in the script where it suddenly went from Nicolas Cage to like this kind of like promised land and on another planet kind of thing. And it irritates me because I know it's only a movie, but there was a potential there to tell an incredible story of the monomyth. And in the end, they went for the Hollywood cheap cop-out. And I think I'm always looking for that in film. I think that's a kind of a very Irish thing too, as well. It's very mythologically based as well. Even Westerns are full of great stories like that, like really great Westerns, like The Search, like that.
Yeah, absolutely. You think of something like High Noon, you know. Yeah. But the other thing, I had not seen 1917 until you did the review of it. And I was like, so I sat down one night and I watched it and I was blown away. Yeah. The art of movie making alone was astonishing with it, right?
How you are actually the third person in that group of two men. You are there with them. And that's a very difficult thing to convey.
And also because they were doing those long shots that just kept going. That's so hard to do.
Very simple dialogue. Very simple dialogue. Everything I think in a great movie like 1917 and films like The Exorcist is another one. And Rosemary's Baby and The Shining is that you fill the dialogue
in. My favorite films.
You fill the dialogue in your own mind in between the actual script.
Yeah. Yeah.
That to me is a thing. If you can do that and you can fall into a film that way, like 1917, it's like one of those things that legitimizes the movie making thing.
Well, to capture the ordinariness of it as well, that and yet draw you in, which is what that movie did, the tiny little details. And Rosemary's Baby does the same thing. It's the ordinariness of it that becomes so frightening that it, you know what I'm saying? And the other movie that...
Rosemary's Baby, right? Yeah. I went around and worked and did a poll. And I said to people, do you actually see the baby in Rosemary's Baby? And every single one of them said yes. Yeah, there was a devil baby in the pram. There was a devil baby in the crib.
No, they never show the baby.
There was no baby. That was all a horror that they put into their own mind after seeing the film.
Yeah.
Interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very interesting. The other one that I had seen before you reviewed it, and it had such a huge effect on me. I kept telling you, you have to see this movie, was A Dark Song. That movie stayed with me for so long. I don't know what spoke to me, but it was just the boring, just the day-to-day,
The mundaneness.
The mundane, thank you. That's the word I'm looking for.
The power of the mundane. And how a film that could deal with such a thing as a child's murder to the subject at hand and then end up as one of the most sort of like beautifully soul-elevating films at the end is just a complete turnaround.
Oh my God. It's almost euphoric, that ending.
And you know, that was filmed in County Wicklow in Ireland. And you're talking about geomancy and landscape. I think a lot of that had to do with the landscape that was filmed in. That in that house and that upland bog, that's a very mystical and spooky place, a very unsettling place to be in. I definitely think that the landscape came across in that film.
Oh yeah, definitely. And just the relationship between the two characters and the magician there that's sort of, you know, guiding her through this is just an ordinary bloke kind of a guy, sort of.
Which is what they always are. The real magicians are not the ones who wear a cloak and
with the stupid hats.
Dress all in black. You know, I'm, you know, Satanicus Immaculata. You know, they're all the larpers and the cosplay fakes.
Yeah, they got that just right. And the other thing is that I've always been fascinated by that Abramelin ritual, and I think a lot of people, but they made it way more cinematic than I think it actually is. I think it's basically a lot of getting up really early and fasting and most of the time, but they had to sort of make it kind of cinematic and give it some razzmatazz, you know, but But oh my God, I love that film. And it pays off. I always say, don't fast forward to the end. You have to watch the whole thing. Yeah. And anyway, that was
I love the part of that film where the plot turns when she had been withholding from Mr. Yeah. Solomon what her actual intention was. And as soon as her intention was lined up with what she actually wanted, that's when shit started happening. And it's just it has nothing to do with ethics or morals or anything. It's just like purity of intent, as in focused intention. And as soon as that intention was focused between Sophia and Solomon, it was like, oh, there's the magic.
Well, Sophia had to die then, the drowning scene. That's again...
Yeah.
This is Orpheus. This is she had to confront the Minotaur in the center of the labyrinth. She had to die. And this is the beautiful thing of bringing this mythological thing into it. When she brought him back, then it was capable of being done. But I love what he said about, you can't get revenge on those kids that killed your child. They're already damned.
Yep. Yeah.
If that's the thing that it's a very difficult lesson for all of us to learn, because we tend to want instant justice and retribution. Yeah. But the reality is that there are unknown codes to the universe which sort these things out one way or another.
Yeah. There's an equation to all of this. And and those old stories address that. They kind of know that we need that. And it's the problem with where we're at as a civilization. And now it's just sort of worldwide that we've, I think deliberately gotten rid of all of that, gotten rid of anything that has any meaning at all, everything.
We've also forgotten the true meaning of what spirituality is. I think spirituality in terms, like, let's talk of movies again. A deeply spiritual movie is Midnight Cowboy with John Voight and Dustin
Hoffman. I agree. Another movie I absolutely love.
The alchemical transformation. Ratso Rizzo plays that alchemical sort of interference within Joe Buck's life to transform him from being an idiot, rube from the woods, and into the man he was meant to be, and dies along the way. I mean, when I watch that film, I find it a very spiritual experience. And yet it takes place in the most depraved elements of New York City back in the late 1960s.
That's an incredibly powerful film.
People think spirituality always has to be this kind of fluffy, loving, the New Age stuff is full of this. They're terrified of confronting the shadow, terrified of seeing the power within that. Do you find that? I find that a lot.
Oh God, yeah. And it's one of the reasons I loved A Dark Song, because talk about facing that shadow. I mean, she literally goes down into sort of the pit of, whatever those beings are. And it's part of her. I think one of the reasons that people have glommed on to this new cult of, what you call needlecraft, is because there is nothing else. There is no, life is devoid of meaning for a lot of people.
It's a compensation. It's a classic Jungian
compensation. Yeah.
Absolutely. It's absolutely. And there's a comfort in that, the same way when World War II was over, there was lots of people in England who would tell you that they missed it when the German bombs were raining down, because it gave meaning to their lives. It brought them together. There was a common struggle. There was a sense of bonding. And I think
that threat of life and death, I don't know if you were ever interested in Gurdjieff, but one of the first books I ever read as a teenager that blew my mind was Meetings with Remarkable Men. And that stayed with me ever since. But Gurdjieff talks in that book about, like, that when he was being fired at, and it was the most alive he ever was. I think that happened. I think that happens to soldiers a lot too. They come home and they don't miss the war as much as they miss that sort of immediacy of life and death being right there in every moment.
Oh yeah. I mean, well, that's what happened to you when you did that audition for Sony Classics. You were up against it and you had to call on other forces outside you to actually bring you there.
I certainly didn't do it consciously, but it just
I don't think anyone ever does. I mean, Joseph Campbell was saying that when he was in college and he used to run races, He was a 1500 meter sprint runner, I think. He said he would knew he was going to win the race before the starting pistol went off or was going to lose it. It was almost like he would slip into a moment where no matter what happens between the next 1500 meters, I'm going to win that race. I can feel it. Yeah. And that's the other, that's the daemon that Anthony Peake talks about a lot. The thing beyond the knowing. I mean, sure, Jason, you could put a lot into that, but lots of us in recent times have gone through huge challenges in our life, even if it's just only the bullshit with the needlecraft, right?
Yeah.
But I think it's created, I keep using the term greatest education ever, because I've learned things about people that have been very unpleasant, and I don't think I can ever see them in the same way again because of their intolerance. At the same time, I've seen things in people who I thought were quite ordinary people who've shown themselves to be extraordinary souls below that. And it was both because of this thing that's going on now.
Yeah.
With that, with what you were just talking about, what both of you just said about that and that incredible moment of kind of being scared into the present moment. And we talk about on the show sometimes with the ability to be projecting your awareness out slightly ahead of time to be able to anticipate something. It's like when those initiation rituals, when somebody's in the middle of combat and their awareness is brought right into the present moment. It's like that. That's what I think they're trying to do with these initiation rites, is because there's so much life force energy that people have held back outside of that present moment, that's hung up in past traumas, that's held up in, you know, ancestral shit. And that ability to bring someone right up to the present moment so that they can be functioning both ahead of time and right there in the moment is what causes that for a lot of troops when they're being fired at. When someone's pointing a gun at you and pulls the trigger, it's like you're right there. You know, people say it's like your life flashes before your eyes. It's almost like what's going on there is your attention that's pulled back in time into your old trauma and everything is whipped right up into that present moment. And that's like actually when someone is, you know, right there in that moment, kind of being initiated or brought into a state where they can, to use the term, to manifest their will in life right there, because they're so in the present moment and ability to project slightly ahead in time.
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah.
Another one I was talking about, people want to see, and I've done a movie review. I've done a book review on it, Last Lakers of Brooklyn by Hubert Selby Jr. That's a story about working class people in Brooklyn, mm-hmm. Navy Yard area back after the World War II period, which is on the surface seems like an incredibly depraved story. And it's just about how hard it is, involving drag queens and prostitutes and drug addicts. But it's absolutely one of the most cathartic, there's that word again, the cathartic things you could ever read or see on cinema, because it takes you through every aspect of life. And that, I think that's back to the whole shadow thing, the darkness of it brings you back to it. Maybe, you know, you were talking about like things resolving themselves. You look at what you were saying about Southern France now, where it's all poverty stricken now. Well, the people who are living in that poverty now are not the descendants of the Cathars. The descendants are the ones who moved in and took the Cathar.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I hate to make it sound like it's just a dump, like a fire, because it is. It is beautiful, and there's still the manor houses there and all that kind of stuff. But it's just, you'd think that an area that's so beautiful and rich in history would just be, you know, just in terms of commerce and everything, just be more successful, but it's not. And
yeah, but some places have corpses hanging over them.
The other thing about that land when you go there is that there is a terrible melancholy.
I've heard that. I've heard that. Yeah. There's parts of Ireland that are like that as well. It's like, you just get me out of here quickly. It's really sad. Yeah. And I think that and there's parts of America, actually parts of New York City, I used to feel that, particularly down the Lower East Side, this tremendous sense of sadness. And then you realize all the immigrants who came through there and what they had to deal with.
Yeah.
You know, that leaves its mark in the actual stone.
Yep. Yeah, same thing here in the Puget Sound region, kind of from Tacoma to the south end of Seattle, there's just this incredible heaviness, and it's like a standing wave of energy from, I don't know whose trauma it is, but there's got to be somebody's trauma there. And, you know, just like what I was talking about before, about people's attention can be still held back on a previous trauma like that. It's like there's got to be people who've reincarnated who still have little bits of their life force hung up in those spots. So like you were saying, Mary, about that Cathar country where they're, you know, the people that have moved in there are the ones that forced them out. It's like there's still got to be some of that trauma left over from the Cathars there that's being held up in present time, like a standing wave, that you know, static electricity that hasn't been discharged yet.
Yeah. Especially, well, you had that lovely woman on who is sort of a specialist who lives in the area. I'm sorry, her name is
escaping. Amanda Radcliffe.
Thank you, Amanda Radcliffe. And she was just talking about experiences at Montserrat and places like that. And that just, it hangs in the air there, you know. I don't know.
I wanted to ask you
a theory
about the Cathar thing, a theory I've had too before, you know, with electronics, you have anode and cathode. And I wondered if there's something inherently hidden within, and I'm, like I said, I've got a very pedestrian knowledge of this, but if there is something hidden within the teachings of the Cathars or the Gnostics about the idea of being able to discharge trauma that way, like the way that you would have flow from an anode to a cathode, like you were talking about the two mountains within the middle there, or excuse me, the two towers within the middle being a mountain, which had the F sharp, the F sharp portal in it, that idea of an anode and a cathode and charge being able to go from one polarity to another polarity. I do wonder if within, not Holy Blood, Holy Grail, I haven't read that, but within any of the oral tradition, if there's the potential of there being something like that about Cathar coming from Cathos, you know, with discharge through catharsis, if there is something there that can, you know, they had within their spiritual tradition, which can help people discharge that type of energy. So it doesn't build up and we don't have these nasty standing waves of energy around the world where heavy incidents occurred.
I don't know about that so much. You just reminded me of something though, that from the Patrice Chaplin book, that I remember in Holy Blood, Holy Grail, there was that thing, je connais Sion, S-I-O-N, I know, yeah. Sion, right? That's, and she said that what she was told is that Sion was Set, Isis, Osiris, and so they were like the opposites, and that it was the one triangle that was the positive, and then the other triangle going down, the negative. And that's part of this initiation process where you would transcend death had to do with these shifting polarities. And not that I know anything about this stuff, but I'm relaying what I remember, that was kind of fascinating.
Did the Cathars have a kind of a karmic concept surrounding reincarnation?
Well, they believed in reincarnation, definitely. I mean, that was essential.
Was there any karmic prices paid in, like you have in Hinduism?
I've never read anything like that about they. Yeah. We just don't have anything from them left, basically. I mean, you know, very few. It was mostly what people that were writing about them said, and that were writing negative things about them. That's basically what we have left about most Gnostics now. It's just what the early church fathers wrote about them. But all we know is that they had a concept of reincarnation. They also think they may have been influenced by sort of whatever was left over of Pythagorean ideas, because it came from Southern Italy, and maybe some of those ideas were transported easily across the Mediterranean to that area. And again, it was, you know, sort of vegetarian asceticism, thought of, you know, concept of reincarnation, things like that. Who knows? But I wanted to bring up something else, because I want to get back to movies for a second, because sure. The 1917 reminded me of sort of those movies by David Lean all around World War I. And there's something I loved, David Lean, and when he was, you know, in his prime, he's dead now, but when those movies came out, he didn't always get reviewed well. And I'm not sure why, because those movies are magnificent.
They're like Ryan's daughter and
Lawrence of Arabia, and also Dr. Zhivago. And and then before that, one of his first films was Brief Encounter, and it's a beautiful film.
Well, I'd be one of those people that in times past would have saw films like Ryan's daughter as being a bit too fluffy and a bit too melodramatic. Right. And so on. But this year, for the very first time ever, I watched Dr. Zhivago from beginning to end, and it left a profound effect on me.
It's a magnificent film.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are moments in that film that never leave you. But I was thinking that he made these films because you talk about World War I sometimes and the great culling of the male population was. And that is another whole area of interest that David Lean, I don't know if he was conscious of this, but every time I see one of his films, it's like sort of a love story captured against sort of a sweeping era of history
and a complicated love story. Someone's married and someone's not married.
It can never be, right? And it's Ryan's daughter and all that, but all of these people were victims of the powers that be at the time, sort of shape, altering the world as we knew it. And that it's these two people against impossible odds and against incidents they can never, ever, ever control.
Well, and there was the world before World War I and the world after. And that's never fully appreciated. The world was a very different place in 1913 than it was in 1919.
And, when I was studying history, when I was younger, there was we just don't know what caused it. It's like, well, so-and-so was shot in Serbia. And it's like, oh no, it goes so far deeper than that. And which leads me, you get into the Fabians and the Tavistock Institute, and you get into Rhodes and
the eugenics movement in America,
the eugenics movement, and da 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 da, and that everything we're going through now, to me, there's a straight line, right?
This is the bookend of World War I. This is the other.
Yes.
I'm absolutely convinced. And it would take me as a person a long time to get to that point that it would actually, but here we go. It's the same aristocrats, aristocrats who've decided there's too many of us. And there's no difference between Klaus Schwab at the Great Reset and H.G. Wells at the Fabian Society. Oh. It's the same playbook again. It's actually
what sort of turned me away from theosophy a little bit, because the early theosophy of Madame Blavatsky and everything, I think it had a freshness and it was amazing. She was an amazing human being. And then when Annie Besant took over, she came out of that whole suffragette movement and had been a Fabian. And it took theosophy in a whole, and you notice that's when Steiner goes the other way. It's like,
it was co-opted. Me and Jason often talked about L. Ron Hubbard, that the early stuff was like, how did it go from that to the mess it became? And obviously because somebody along the line had said, we can use this, and jumped in. A classic example is the suffragettes. What's his name? Arthur Conan Doyle, was it? Yes, it was Arthur Conan Doyle. He was against the women's vote during the suffragette movement, based primarily on he only encountered suffragettes. During World War I, he met all these girls who worked in ammunition factories, and in particular in a place, gigantic factory, funny enough, in Roslyn, where Roslyn Chapel is, in Scotland. And they were all ordinary working class Scottish girls. And it was meeting them that made him convinced that women should have the vote, not the suffragettes, which shows you it's how things work, that kind of thing. It's almost like the nasty, freedom is attained by ordinary people who deserve it, not by elitists who demand it.
Right. They're always, with a lot of those movements, it's always the elite of society, the sons and daughters of the posh people that end up, like now.
Yeah. And I wish more people would just wake up to what's going on right now. Now, unfortunately, we do have the presence of hindsight for those of us who care enough to look at the past. But unfortunately, there's not enough of us. There's much more of us than I thought there would be, but there's still not enough. And that's, we are living through history. We all know what happened in 1919. I'm more concerned now at what happens on the other side of this thing.
Yeah.
We'll be given our world back again, our normal life again, but it'll come with a whole new cultural way of thinking. That I just, like I often say, to have my friends who often say, I'm glad, and I'm sure you feel the same, you and your husband have the same conversations. I'm glad we were born when we were born and grew up when we grew up, because it's like, I really don't envy young people today what they're facing.
No.
I really don't.
I mean, it's not just the great music we grew up with, which is so much better.
Freedom.
Oh my God.
The freedom. I mean,
we took it for granted, obviously, but I'm glad I was born when I was born.
I know, how people like you and I ended up in the Lower East Side of New York when we did at the ages we did, that doesn't happen anymore. You know, and that was like a normal thing you did back then if you were a little bit more sort of outside the box.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, when I think back at that, like the bravery you have to show when you're that age to do that, and yet we just did it nonchalant because we were used to living in a world where we could go where we wanted and do what we wanted.
Yeah. And I think, well, both of us certainly grew up with a tremendous degree of self-reliance and taking personal responsibility for everything, not blaming anybody for anything ever in your life. Just so, which is not the way that most children are raised these days.
Also a greater richness. There was a greater richness to life as well. I just think it's something like picking up an album and examining the liner notes and putting that ritual of putting it on the turntable
and then
turning it over. It's what hipsters do now to get rid of their boredom. But it's what when we did it, it was religious. It was spiritual.
Yeah, really. I do miss that this was holding the album and the liner notes, just pouring over them and everything. It's also was a time when you'd listen to the whole record, you'd put it on and that's a good 25 minutes on one side or 20 minutes on one side. I have to admit, I don't listen to music that way anymore. It's like, no, yes, no. It's just the way it is.
It's like a romance that's gone. You can never go back. In some way.
You can never go back. But it will be interesting to see what happens. I've known my whole life, in a weird way, that something like this, I didn't think it'd be this. I'll be honest with you. I didn't think they'd have the balls to do this, but they did.
Yeah.
You gotta admire that, and in a weird way. But no, but I've been prepared for this. I knew something was, I didn't know what, but so. And because of that, I have a garden. I learned how to grow food on my own. I'm totally dependent on my garden, but I do. And we have hens, we have guinea hens, and they lay eggs and eat ticks. We're off the grid. We have all our own electricity, things like that. Just little by little, I did enough because I'm some crazy prepper. I just thought, I should do that. That'd be a good idea. Yeah. I don't want to be at the mercy of anybody if things really, really go bad. And they could have gone bad for a lot of different reasons. So other thing I've been doing lately is just collecting. I don't know why I do it. But I keep thinking, I should get the hard copy of that book just cause, and just books on things I have no interest in, like math. Like, it's like, if I see something out at like a secondhand bookstore, I'll be like, I should just get that.
You're subconsciously preserving the past. That's why. I'm doing the same with DVDs. This is the golden age of collecting DVDs for like a euro each at charity shops. And I've built up a fantastic film collection that I'll spend years watching. And I think it's almost like that's my way of preserving, archiving the past, because is there what you know?
That's, you need to do this.
Yeah, because right now it's obvious they're doing a year zero thing. They want, like, this is the old world is gone, this is the new world. And it had no value or no worth or anything like that. But we all know it had plenty of value and plenty of worth. And in fact, more than what they're offering. And I think that's why I think a lot of us are dipping into our past right now for that reason, because it's like, hold on, the old world was better than the Great Reset. Sorry, it just was, you know. And ownership is not necessarily materialism. Ownership can be knowledge, films, books, art, music. That's not ownership for materialistic reasons. We don't own things because we have the latest iPhones. We own things because they enrich our soul. And these idiots, these billionaire idiots at the likes of the World Economic Forum, have no idea of that preciousness of that kind of ownership as compared to their only understanding, which is materialism. Yeah. How many yachts they have.
Yeah. It's also, I think, if you ever had to redesign an education system, like Thomas, if I said to you, okay, Thomas, here you go. You gotta design an education for kids. It's, what would you do? And I keep thinking to grab history books and everything. The other thing, in my family, we all loved history. And so whenever you read something, we always thought you got to read the opposite view of it. Like, just get every angle in that you can see, because the past is more complicated than they would have you believe. And so what's considered, I guess, standard for education isn't always, as we know, the true history of anything. So I always try to think, you know, if I think this, maybe I should see the opposite side. Let me see what they have to say, and then see how, so, you know what I mean? And the truth is somewhere in there.
And that's because it's so taboo by academia to look at things from both sides.
I got to tell you, being married to someone in academia, it's, let's just say, in terms of scholarship, he who pays the piper calls the tune.
Yeah.
You know, that's the way things are. It's all about getting grants and money for things. And
which is not their fault.
No, it isn't. It isn't. But sometimes I wish that's the only time I wish I was a billionaire, because I would just want to fund things would be important. And I don't know.
Yeah, anyway. That's how I feel, but they wouldn't let us have the money for that reason. What were you going to say, Jason?
Oh, I'll go down the rabbit hole again. You guys were both talking about something with Thomas. You mentioned the bookends of World War I, and here we are in World War IV now, if we want to think of it that way, that if their plan with the Great War and the Great Reset basically essentially being the same end of the closing rites of a ritual, it really does seem like they want to round up souls and put them into this this virtual reality type of thing where there is no more real world around here. And potentially what I think they might actually be trying to do is actually zap the life force entity out of people and draw it into that metaverse or whatever it is that they're putting, that everybody's putting their attention on right now. But just this idea too, like with the Gnostic thing you were talking about earlier, Mary, that this idea that somehow this reality that we live in is an evil thing. It's like that neo-Gnostic idea kind of comes through in the, you know, the globalist agenda of things, that this, you know, physical reality around us and reproduction and everything is evil. You know, they all the alphabet types and everything, you know, cutting off the reproductive organs.
They don't see anything transcendent. Right. At least the Gnostics did see something transcendent beyond all this. They don't.
Right.
And Steiner talked about that, where we're going with all of this sort of, you know, techno-fascism is he called it the eighth sphere, which is exactly what you were just talking about, where, you know, we're, you know, sort of this human machine hybrid that they would like us to become, and leaving the rest of us down here sort of, you know, just hooked up to some virtual reality existence. He addressed it. Steiner said, I don't want to keep pushing Steiner, because a lot of it, I'll be honest, I don't understand, because, you know, as if you've ever read a lot of him, it's like, oh my God, I can only read a little bit at a time. And I used to think it was because it was the translation, maybe from the German.
No, those run-on sentences used to drive me crazy.
I can't, but he did say, you can't fight it. You have to just be aware of it. You just have to know it's there. He called it sort of that whole aramonic, like it was an aramonic energy. So for him, evil was sort of this techno-fascist kind of Aramonic energy that we're seeing now that's so prevalent everywhere. And he also acknowledged a very different energy that he didn't think was as bad at all, which was the Luciferic energy. And that was sort of that Promethean impulse in humanity, which was enlightenment and all of that stuff, which was fine for its time and good. It's when that element gets with the Aramonic element and those two get together, it's not good. That's when the arrogance that sometimes that Luciferic enlightenment mentality can have, I'm God, I can do this. And then you put that with that techno-fascistic kind of energy of the Aramon and you got a bad combination there.
Okay, let's run with that. We're big fans here of this whole concept. Talk about the Aramonic elements. Do you believe there are unseen beings behind the force, behind this unseen beings, entities?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. There's no doubt in my mind whatsoever. And the other thing is, just as an aside, because I know I can go off on tangents, I am, for various reasons, I follow a number of remote viewers. One of them, Dick Allgaier, is one of the best in the world. And remote viewing is not really a psychic thing. I mean, if you're psychic, you're better at it, obviously, but it's a way of, I think artists do it. It's a way of seeing the future. And anyway, it's a,
That's right up Jason's book. You two can have take the show over from this point. Go on.
Okay. Well, Dick Allgaier.
Yeah, Dick Allgaier is great. Yeah.
He's fabulous. And I'm a huge fan of his. So he remote viewed lots of different things, but he keeps seeing these ships out in, if you know what I'm talking about, he's around the earth. And he said, they're like gods and they're playing games with us. He said, it's like a chess game and it's winner take all. And he said, and they've always been there and they're watching us and they play games and they say, now we're going to put this in. They remote viewed, the laws of Hammurabi. And I mean, when you see the remote, they don't know what they're looking at. They're not allowed to know what the topic is. It could be looking at the Eiffel Tower or, you know, the pyramids or a cryptocurrency. So they don't know. So when they come out with this and it's so accurate, dead on. And when he said they're playing chess with us, it's a game. It's so dovetailed with Thomas, what you've been saying lately. Someone's playing a game with us. And I've always thought we have owners. We've always had owners.
The secret unknowns, as Andy Garcia called them in Godfather 3, yeah.
It's almost like the game that they're playing, there's a physical chessboard and there are pieces and those pieces have human souls in them, you know, all of us, and we're being played like that, but it's almost like their end game is to ensure that all the pieces and the board and everything go away at the end. It's not a game of chess where the king gets taken. It's a game where, you know, all the pieces and the board end up disappearing at the end.
So maybe that's what happened in like some of these eras that were lost, you know, lost civilizations. Just like, we're going to start sweep the board and start all over again. I don't know. I have to believe that somewhere something is helping us a little bit. I send you things sometimes because I think Thomas has to see this. And I sent you Cliff High talking about, but also I sent you that thing about it was about Del Shao and the airships of the late 19th century but talking specifically about the Junkers and how they permeated Prussian culture and kind of double crossed the Teutonic Knights and basically took over, and they were that bureaucratic class, cold hard technocrat bureaucrats, and that they have been sort of running things ever since. And I always feel like they're the foot soldiers of whoever these unknowns are.
Well, going back my work for years, I've been aware of this whole Prussian influence.
I know, you talk about it a lot.
And the strangeness of it, and the all pervasive element of it, right back to Frederick the Great. And this bizarre thing where he had this shamanic experience when his boyfriend's head was chopped off in front of him by his father. It was almost like some entities jumped into the Prussian royal family, because then it changed the history of the world from that point on. And everything from education to our government structures to everything is now based on Prussian, this Prussian aristocratic values. And yet, if you ask the average person, what do you know about Prussia? They'll go, wasn't that a country that once was part of Germany? And at the, and yet it has left a bigger influence on the world than the British Empire.
Yeah, yeah.
Memories erased.
And then post-World War II, when you get the amalgamation of that British influence with, you know, Milner and his kindergarten and the Tavistock Institute and the Fabians, and then they all kind of get together. It's like, you know what? Let's just all be one big happy family now. So you have that Prussian influence, and you have, you know, the whole central bank influence. You have all of these, and now they all seem to be working together. And here we are.
Yeah.
With what you said, Mary, about the players outside, you know, that have been remote viewed and there being help out there, I think one of the biggest things that we all forget is that we are just as much of a player as those gods out there are. And one of the biggest tricks here on Earth in our existence is letting people know that they aren't divine themselves, that they aren't as much of a creator god as all the creator gods out there are, that we are the exact same thing, but that, you know, the Tavistock Institute that you've mentioned and everybody, you know, all the secret unknowns, their whole end game is to ensure that we don't remember or don't know that we are a spiritual being in a human body, that we're, you know, that we're a god in human form and have as much playing ability, but, you know, we could be potentially limited by our nervous system. But things like remote viewing are just incredibly ordinary things to do, that the human nervous system and the interface that we have with it through the mind and the body, it's terribly normal. Yeah. Incredibly normal. And there's so many things like that.
Can you guys tell me about some of the things that have been remotely viewed in the future that haven't happened yet that you've heard about? None of these people have mentioned.
Well, the remote viewers that I follow, they remote viewed the death of the dollar and what would surround that. And they saw sort of the United States falling apart, basically. This was a couple of years ago that they remote viewed that. I mean, way down, they don't deal with a lot of topics way, way down in the future.
Right.
They remote view a lot of things in the past.
Antarctica.
That's another subject.
That's a whole other show, yeah.
I saw a documentary once about the remote viewers who worked for the CIA.
Yep.
And they were drawing complex maps of parts, remote parts of Siberia where Russian factories and stuff were, that nobody even knew about and were later confirmed by satellite photographs.
I met one of those guys at the Monroe Institute. My husband took me there for my 60th birthday because I always wanted to go. It was fun. It was like summer camp for grownups. It was fun. I met really interesting people. It wasn't the typical sort of new agey types there. It's all different people from all over the world. It was fun. I didn't have the out of body experience. I had some interesting experiences, but some people there definitely did. And there was a doctor from Saudi Arabia there, and he was wonderful. And I don't know. They deal with very short term viewing most of the time. Those guys.
Mary, didn't you grow up on Suffolk County in Long Island?
No, I didn't. I grew up in Rockland County. I grew up right around Bear Mountain, if you remember that area on the Hudson.
Oh, I know that area. Yeah, I know that area.
A little Hudson River town, opposite side of New York, just above New Jersey. If you know, like, Nyack and those towns up there.
Yeah,
that's where I grew up.
I used to go hiking and everything all around there. Yeah.
Oh, Harriman Park was right.
Harriman Park, yeah.
It's right next to where I live. Absolutely, where
it's a nice place to grow up.
It was a lovely place to grow up.
When you go into the back hills around there, you can definitely feel the old, like, Native American energies and the leather stacking tails and all that stuff.
Yeah. Oh, it's beautiful, and that part of the river is so stunning, especially when you go up around Bear Mountain. It's I've never grown tired of that view ever, ever, ever. I don't live there now, but I can see the Delaware right now. But It's so interesting. As I said, I don't know where all of this is leading us, but Thomas, with especially just sort of the practical information that you convey in your books, you know, and everything. I feel like humans are more powerful than we give ourselves credit for. And I've always said reality is way more malleable than you give it credit for. So there's a place for magic in all of this,
yeah,
where you can, in a positive way, take control of things a little bit, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day,
all about the charge.
Yeah, exactly. And at the end of the day, and people should remember this watching the show, what we're talking about, with all the machinations going on at the global level, there's lots of space for us to be the people we were meant to be within that. And that's what we have to do. We have to find that space, And that's it. That's the secret. And in that space, grow, create.
Yeah, because of you, I said, well, to hell with it. I'm just going to make a couple more records while we're all locked down. And I had a good time. I just decided I wasn't going to focus on those things. Energy goes where the attention goes. And so I've just been putting my attention on trying to put it on beautiful things. And I do have a Twitter feed that I follow, and I was getting a little too addicted to the, you know, the news feed, because it just gives you that adrenaline. And so I curated the whole thing and put in, you know, beautiful people that sort of have nice feeds of beautiful art and things like that. It made a huge difference to me.
Well, hold on a second. You're not telling me that I ended your music career, did you?
No, you didn't end my music career. No. I kept making stuff. And you know, I love it when you leave us with keep a song in your heart and create. And it's like, yeah, I got to do that. And then I did. So I have another record coming out in the spring, hopefully. So
what will that be like?
Well, I want it to be kind of a surprise. So it will be in surround again. I decided that I had this whole other fan base come as a result of that surround sound record. So, and it's so much fun to have that. So we're doing that in surround as well. And it's doing things I've always wanted to do. So we'll see. You'll see. It'll come out. It'll be fun. I'll send you one. And I made a French record. Nobody cares about me singing French music. So, but I just wanted to do it because it brought me happiness. And I've never done this. I've never had this career for money, because God knows I never made any. And it's always, because this is what I do. And I like to, I love to perform it for people. And it's when you talk about being in your Dharma, you know, when the world is singing, when it's all singing at once and you're in your Dharma, you're doing what you should be doing. And that's, for me, that's singing and performing. And I'm going to do it as long as I can. And we'll see how long that lasts.
A friend of mine in Scotland, who's a lifelong musician, said that with the death of the traditional music industry, it just made him actually enjoy music more, because he was doing it for himself rather than as a product.
Yeah. And there's, you know, I don't have that pressure on me anymore of like, oh, I have to get a record deal. It's like, who cares? They wouldn't give one to me anyway. So it sort of freed me up, and I like it. You know, I run my own place, everything. I like it. And as long as I can keep performing, that's because I start languishing when I can't do that. I like that one-on-one connection with people.
When you're playing live now, is it just yourself on stage, or do you have a band?
It depends. This weekend I have a couple of shows, and I love to perform with the whole band. It's just more expansive and sounds better and everything. I perform with a guitar because I have to, because I can't afford to take an entire band with me across the country. So it's just me, and I play a souped up electric guitar that's, you know, just very, it covers a multitude of sins. Let's put it that way. I wish I could play the way that my music director plays, but I don't overplay, which is a good thing.
I think your playing is very good. It's very confident. The style of guitar playing you're playing is great for filling in your voice.
It's atmospheric.
It works.
It up.
Yeah.
I use, you know, just a lot of delay and reverb, and I soup it up, and I don't.
I love all that stuff. Yeah, it's great.
I love that stuff too. So it's good. It does the trick. And but when I go anywhere out of the Northeast, then it's just me and a guitar. And the thing I love to do with people is I like to see them after the show, and I like to touch people. I like to you know, people are very, very lonely, and even before all this happened. So I'm very tactile with people after the show, and I think they need it. So it's not just the on stage, it's after the show too.
Oh yeah.
And I have a real conversation with every single person who comes to see me after the show. And I think
tell people what your gig's coming up are. They're probably going.
Oh, well, I don't think you have. If you do have someone in the audience who's around here, I'd love to meet them. We should go have coffee. And I'm in Easton, Pennsylvania, on the Delaware, but this is going to be in Jim Thorpe, Pennsylvania. And it's sort of a very Christmassy kind of town. It's the Mock Chunk Opera House. So I'll be there on Friday night. And those are my shows this weekend.
And your website will have all your gigs listed on it anyway, right?
Everything. Yes, right. Everything. And so please, you know, if you're in that area, I'd love to meet you. And Mark Stavish lives in that area. I love his work too. Did you read that Egregore's book that he wrote?
I've not read it, but I do know about the book. Yeah,
it's a good book for the layperson. To understand the whole concept of egregores. It's very, very well done. He's one of the few people other than the Parallel Society and everything that I actually follow on Facebook, because I try to, Facebook can be very annoying. So I just, it's like you and him and a few other people, and that's it. I try to get
in. And BR313.
Of course. Yeah. And then I just, get out of there as fast as I can.
No, it's a good way to do it. Listen, we've covered a lot now, I think.
I hope I didn't ramble.
No, you're coming.
Mary, you got to hand the ball to somebody else once in a while.
No, you're coming back. It's just, I've got work in the morning. But Jason, before we wrap up, what do you want to say to Mary?
Oh, no, Mary, this has just been wonderful. And I definitely do want to reach out to you about some of those 5.1 albums. That sounds amazing.
Send me your address. I'll get one out to you tomorrow.
Will do.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I've loved this. And have me on the pub sometime, too, because I love
I'll send
pub.
You the link.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, definitely. You see, the thing is that I think you're a bit too posh for us.
Oh, come on. You don't know me then.
I have to say to all of them, we have some class here tonight, so behave yourself. especially me. But
I loved it. I listened last night. It's really fun. I love it. It's funny. It's a whole different thing.
Yeah.
So it's great. But keep doing what you're doing, because it's very important for so many of us. It makes those of us out here. I'm not a joiner. So I don't have I have a handful of really close friends who have come through like spades through all of this craziness. And I'm lucky for that and my family. And, but other than that, I don't have like groups or anything like that. So it's this online tribe that I'm very, very happy that I stumbled upon a few years ago. And thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, Mary, I'm very honored to hear that. And thank you for coming on. Thank you for, do you have to answer the phone? Because we can edit this out.
I thought I turned that off. Okay.
You can answer the phone. If it's important, go ahead. We can make
it. No, I put the phone in the other room.
Okay. But anyway, so Mary, thanks for being here. It's just been beautiful, actually. And I want to thank you personally for writing and recording a record that has been such a haunting tune in my own, a song in my own heart returned to me. And it's not often you meet your heroes. You're the second one. I met Steve Hughes here as well, but it's like the comedian, but it's like, it's lovely to meet someone that you look up to and that just like, you a normal person or you know, anything. So I think everyone's going to love the show tonight, and you're definitely coming back. I'm going to insist on it. And so thanks, Jason, again for manning the controls.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you so much.
And we'll leave the link to your website, and I'll put the video to return to me in the comments so people can see it there if they haven't heard it. And
you know, there's a better video. I think the video that Sony did is they spent $100,000 on the stupidest video I've ever seen in my life. And
it's the part of the cave I don't get. What's that?
It was so bad. It was so bad. That was the Batcave in LA. They filmed that in the Batcave, the thing that was used for Batman. And the problem was we didn't dance or move. So it's just, the thing is with cinematography, if you're not moving, the camera has to. So something has to be moving. And it was this static camera and static us. And it was just sitting. It was so awkward. And
you know, a part I like best in the video is, the scene with the model airplane at the beginning, I didn't really get that, but I did like when the radio came on. I did like that bit when it went from lo-fi to the song. I love that part. Yeah. But my favorite part of the video is when the two of you are kind of on a road beside a field outside singing.
Yeah.
That looks great. That looks really good.
It was a pretty good shot of all of it. It made no sense, but
It's a song that matters. It's a song that matters.
Well, there's a nice version of it that I got to do with a local youth orchestra. And it has the orchestra with it. So it sweeps up. It's take a listen before you do it. It's very, very beautiful. And the kids make a few mistakes, but it's okay. Anyway, I've had a wonderful time. I could go on and on and on. I could do this every night with you guys. So I've loved it. Have me back, and good luck. And we're all in this together.
Absolutely. And that's. I'll leave it with that. Good night, everybody. Thanks again, Mary. Thanks, Jason. And we'll see you all on the next BR313 Symposium. And look after yourselves, okay?
God bless.
Bye-bye.